vida para mí. Así es la vida, tú sabes.
Todo se va.
Okay, thank you all for joining us tonight on this Friday. We decided to have this webinar tonight to discuss a major decision that was recently announced about MCIs. We know this meeting will be very helpful and a great insight into the newly announced judgment. Tonight we have Michelle McGinnis, attorney at the law firm Collins, Dotkin, and Miller LLP, to give us this update. Michelle recently presented at our last webinar on MCI increases, and we got amazing feedback from our viewers. And you know, we want to make this webinar more of a discussion tonight, so we will be allowing some questions to be asked live. So once Michelle is finished explaining the court decision, we will open the floor for questions and comments. So, you know, we still will have our Q&A box open. And, you know, yeah, tonight will be more of like more of a discussion forum. We do have interpretation tonight as well. So I ask if you should click on the globe at the bottom of your screen and select your appropriate listening language. So now, I will let Michelle introduce herself and, you know, start discussing the MCI court decision.
All right. Good evening, everyone. As Jakari said, my name is Michelle McGinnis, and I'm an attorney with the law firm of Collins, Dopkin, and Miller. We're here tonight to talk about a very exciting recent decision by the New York Supreme Court, which held for the first time that DHCR was required to rule separately on whether costs are depreciable before granting an MCI rent increase. In the case, our firm represented the Stuyvesant Town Peter Cooper Village Tenants Association in challenging several orders issued by DHCR, which granted the owners MCI rent increases for facade work. If you've attended previous Palante panels on major capital improvements, or if you've challenged a landlord's application for an MCI rent increase at DHCR, you probably know that under the rent stabilization law and the rent stabilization code, it's required that all MCI work be depreciable under the Internal Revenue Code and not for ordinary repair. Despite this unequivocal requirement, for years, DHCR has avoided determining whether work in a particular MCI application was actually considered depreciable under federal standards. Instead, if DHCR has approved MCI rent increases, so long as the work at issue met standards established by DHCR, and those generally appear on the schedule of major capital improvements in the rent stabilization code. In the Stuyvesant Town Peter Cooper Village decision, the court agreed with the Tenants Association that DHCR was not permitted to substitute its own standards for federal depreciability standards. So in holding that DHCR failed to make a determination on depreciability in the MCI orders it issued, the court cited the lack of evidence in the order showing that DHCR considered any of the factors set forth by the US tax courts, which says that to be depreciable, work has to be performed for the first time, improve the building by creating something entirely new, or be of a significant scale. Yes. Absolutely. The criteria from the US tax court, which the court cited, is that to be depreciable, the work has to be performed for the first time, improve the building by creating something entirely new or be of significant scale. So significantly, as the title of this webinar is, the court decision requires that DHCR now make a separate determination as to whether the work in an MCI application is depreciable under federal standards, not just DHCR standards. So what this means is that just because work may appear on the schedule of major capital improvements in the rent stabilization code, it doesn't automatically qualify as a major capital improvement. So I was going to jump a tiny bit into the specific issue in this case, which was local law 11 work, but I do want to make sure that folks have an idea and understanding of what I've just explained regarding the depreciability. So if there's any questions about that, please ask them. Well, I think they're silent, so I guess not, but anyway, so in these particular cases, it had to do with local law 11 work. If you're tenants and you've worked with MCIs, you might know that landlords routinely file and Mr. get.
I'm yes. sorry to interrupt.
Sure.
We have a question from someone.
Sure. Okay. Yes. So
I'm going to let them, give me a second.
Sure.
Okay, so Mr. Sue, Ms. Sue, Sue's man.
Hi, thank you.
Okay.
So the question, I heard you say or, so it's
yes.
It could be either of any of those three. It doesn't have to be depreciable if it is.
That's correct. Yes, it could be there. The standards, the specific standards, the court, put in the decision relate to a particular case that we discussed and relied on, which was a U.S. tax court decision that sort of gave an overview of what qualifies as a depreciable expense under the Internal Revenue Code. And those three things, it doesn't have to be all three, but one of them. Right, you have to, the work just basically, it can't just be repair, and certainly jumping into local law 11, it can't just be minor repairs associated with local law 11. So if tenants have, been involved with MCIs, they might know that landlords frequently submit MCIs for local law 11 work, which was the specific issue in the Tenants Association appeal here. So under local law 11, which is now called the Facade Inspections and Safety Program, owners of buildings with six or more stories are required to inspect and repair as necessary every 5 years. And for decades, DHCR has granted MCI rent increases for this facade work, even when only a small fraction of the facade was pointed, which is frequently the case in local law 11. And DHCR's reasoning was that so long as the work was performed as necessary, then the work was deemed comprehensive and thus qualified as an MCI. In our particular case, the owner pointed, in some of the buildings, 1% of the entire facade, which the, relying on Merriam-Webster's definition of comprehensive, the court said, that is not comprehensive. It can't possibly be comprehensive. And so what the court held was that DHCR's policy violated the rent stabilization law and the rent stabilization code because it failed to address depreciability. And again, that DHCR is required now to first determine whether work is depreciable under federal standards before determining whether the work in these particular cases was completed as necessary. And then this is good for all tenants who want to object to local law 11 work. The court said that it was unlikely that routine Local Law 11 work performed every 5 years as required by statute constituted a repair or improvement for the purposes of an MCI. The decision is significant, of course, because it creates a requirement now that DHCR make a separate determination, which DHCR has avoided for decades doing. You know, our firm has worked on this for years, this issue, as have other law firms. So we're very, very happy, you know, with the court's decision, of course. And, you know, although DHCR can still appeal the decision, they still might, it's still within appeal time. You know, it's the we feel that the decision is fairly strong on the law, and especially because the rent stabilization law requires that work be depreciable under federal standards, it's hard to know what the challenge would be. But I would like to open it up for questions. I think, as Jakari said at the start, it would be great if this could be a bit like a discussion. And if folks are brave and want to, you know, join in, that would be great. Questions and things.
Ms. Suzman is still, she's unmuted still. So you can ask your question if you still want to.
I'm sorry, I have one more question. And that was, what happens if a landlord is negligent and delays doing Local Law 11 work for enough time that the work becomes, can the work become significant because the landlord has been negligent about taking care of it?
Well, I think that the, you know, there, if a landlord does, say, like an exterior restoration, where, you know, that they're doing a significant portion, the court cite in the decision, the court cites to one case where 80% of the facade was repointed. So, you know, which sort of gives like a scale between 1% is no good, 80% seems good if you redo 80% of the facade. So to answer your question, if a landlord neglects and they end up having to replace most of the facade, 80% of the facade, if it were depreciable under the internal, if that work is depreciable under the Internal Revenue Code, then it would qualify as an MCI. You know, there's a difference between repair work and, you know, work that is depreciable. So, you know, it would depend on the facts, I would think, of the particular case. I don't think just neglect would mean, you know, on that basis alone would cancel out an MCI. It's, you know, it's going to be based on what the actual work performed was about. And I see that someone wanted the name of the case. What I'm going to do is I can put a link to the case directly into the question box. Is that, am I able to do that? Yeah.
I could do it for you. I got it.
Right. Okay. So, and that way it was the Stuyvesant Town, Peter Cooper Village Tenants Association. Susan Steinberg is president versus DHCR and the owners, of course, the, you know, Stuy Town owners, BPP, ST owners, and BPP. PCV owners, and I can give an index number if folks want, if you're looking, but there's a link now, but well, the that, index that number.
That link is incorrect.
Hold on. Oh, the link didn't go in, but the index number, if you, you know, folks wanted to look it up, is 154097 of 2021. So let's see. So, oh, it didn't go. I don't think it went. Let's see. I think there's, we answered
the chat.
What's that?
It does appear in the chat, which is otherwise disabled, so that it might work. That might work.
Oh, I see. Are you able to click on that link?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'll be quiet. I just wanted to say thank you so much for doing this case and for doing this event. It's terrific. Thank you.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah. Thank you, Sue. This, I don't know, Jakari, if that works. It does not work. That link.
But I think we're gonna make sure everybody gets the link to the
actual. Okay. Sounds good.
And Michelle, your camera, I think, went up a little bit.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, my camera's acting a little bit funky. Sorry about that.
And then there was another question. It says, when does this law go into effect and do we have to wait to see it if DHCR appeals? I think you answered that.
I would know the law right now, it's not a law, it's a case, right? It's a case that's interpreted the law, and the case says, this is what the law says, DHCR, this is what you have to do to be in compliance with the law, right? That's what the case says. So it's not a law, it's a case that interprets the law. And it's effective now. If tenants are objecting to MCIs as one of the objections, certainly raising issue, especially if it's local law 11 work, which, you know, there's language in the decision, which really challenges that work performed every 5 years, which, by the way, just wouldn't even meet the useful life of facade work on the, DHCR's useful life schedule, you know, which is 15 or 25 years. I mean, how can you, you know, that kind of work would actually be depreciable. And I see that my camera went down again, and I really apologize for that. I'm gonna just try to make this better.
So we just had another question come in.
Yes.
And they, this attendee came in a little late. So they wanted to know if you could repeat the three eligible qualifications for MCI.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah. And they're also in the decision. And again, these are taken from a particular case that was called Universal Mills v. Commissioner by the United States Tax Court. And the three factors are that it was either, right? It's performed for the first time. It improves the building by creating something entirely new, which, for example, if we stick to facade work, would be, you know, repointing the whole facade, right? The facade is, you know, pretty much, you know, gone, and you're going to recreate the whole thing. So you're left with something new that, you know, will meet the useful life of 25 years for an exterior restoration, right? So that, and then the third thing is that, or it is of significant scale. And, you know, that is, you know, obviously like doing something small, pointing, you know, one portion of a building wouldn't qualify, or replacing, you know, well, there's already these factors, but replacing one window in a building wouldn't qualify. It has to be major. It can't be a repair to something that's not going to leave you in a it's not going to increase the value of the building. And I will say that although these are the three factors that the court cited in its decision taken from this particular case, they're not the only factors. You know, the tax court and the U.S. Treasury Department and the Internal Revenue Service published guidelines, and there's, you know, lots of information, but the cases do definitely revolve around these three factors, you know, plus other factors to be depreciable. And there's a big distinction between work that is a repair and work that can be capitalized. And one of the key, you know, one of the points that we made when we litigated this is the, you know, if some of the tenants here know, for example, or are familiar with, you know, tenant law and how courts have interpreted and require tenants, say in a non-primary case, if a tenant, you know, puts another address down on their tax returns, the courts say, there's a case called Unwin where the courts say, you can't say two different things to two different forums. You can't tell the federal government on your tax returns, I live here or I work here, and then tell the court, oh no, I actually live here, right? That says they're logically incompatible. Using that same logic, we argued that an owner cannot submit tax returns and take a deduction based on repairs for federal purposes and then turn around and tell the state, oh no, this is a, you know, this is a capitalized expense. And they never have to say that because DHCR has never requested that they, that the work, they actually show or prove that the work was capitalized on their tax returns. You know, so these, you know, the, we made the point, which is valid, that, you know, the tenants can't do it. And there's a principle of law that you can't tell two different forms, the federal government one thing and the state government another. And that should apply here as well. That, you know, an owner can't tell the IRS one thing and DHCR another regarding the same work. Mm-hmm. You know, owners generally, I think, as far as I know, I'm not a CPA, but owners generally prefer for some things, of course, to be repaired because you get an instant deduction where if it's capitalized, it's capitalized over a number of years. So there's a more immediate benefit to declare things as repairs. And they shouldn't be doing that and getting MCI rent increases from the tenants as well.
Right.
Yeah.
Also, if you guys want, like I said, tonight we're doing a little things different. So if you do want to ask your question live, you can. So you actually can ask Michelle it herself. You can just raise your hand and then I will allow you to speak. And we have another question that came in. It says, what is the year of local law 11?
I think local law 11 was in the 70s. It came about because literally because, you know, a brick fell off a building and hit, you know, a pedestrian's head and she was killed up by Columbia. So I think that was in like the 70s or early 80s is my recollection. I could be wrong, but somewhere around there, local law 11 was enacted specifically to make sure that bricks don't fall on pedestrians' heads. That was the purpose of it, The purpose of the law. And I see our DHCR and Blackstone likely to appeal. Well, they have a 30-day period, so they have until, you know, sometime in February to decide. I don't know if they will appeal. They, you know, they certainly might, but then again, the decision seems fairly strong in the law because the law does indeed require that work be depreciable under federal standards. So, you know, they can certainly do that. I'm not sure, you know, they made their arguments before the Supreme Court and the Supreme Court did not buy those arguments that they made.
Okay.
Yeah.
So right now I don't see
any more questions
at the moment. You can show the schedule of major capital improvements if you would like. You can go to this.
Yeah. Sure. So, and for tenants doing something, right? So let's say like the schedule of major capital improvements, how DHCR has operated, right, is that if it's on this schedule, right, this is it. If any of these things listed here, you know, air conditioner, aluminum siding, they're automatically qualify as an MCI, provided they meet the other qualifications minus depreciability, right? They have to meet the useful life and, you know, the other qualifications, but there's never been a requirement that they also be depreciable. So if you are working on an MCI or challenging any MCI, you know, you definitely should raise a question as to whether or not the work is considered depreciable under the Internal Revenue Code. Absolutely.
Okay.
Are there no more questions?
Okay, we just got one. It says, do landlords do both, get a major capital improvement increase and take a depreciation?
Well, sure, they can, on their federal tax returns, right, they can capitalize expenses. And for purposes of the DHCR granting a rent increase, yes, they can get a rent increase if it's capitalized. If they claim it as a depreciable expense on their tax returns, they can get an MCI. If they don't, they shouldn't, right? They, you know, because they shouldn't be sort of double dipping, you know, getting it as a, treating it as a repair expense for federal purposes and a capitalized expense for DHCR purposes. So yes, they can get, yes, if it's capitalized, if it's claimed as a depreciable expense, and it's obviously the IRS accepts it as a depreciable expense, and it, you know, meets their qualifications, then yes, it would meet the qualifications for a major capital improvement. You know, the big thing here is really, you know, going outside of DHCR to determine depreciability and actually relying on federal standards of depreciability rather than how DHCR has sort of, you know, defined it over the years and wrapped it up so that there's, you know, there's work can absolutely not be depreciable but still be an MCI, which is, you know, some of the work on the major capital, you know, the schedule of major capital improvements.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Instead, what does capitalized expense mean?
It means that, so if you are, if work is depreciable, then it gets capitalized over a period of time. So if you spend $100 on something and it's a depreciable expense, then that $100 is spread out over a period of time, as opposed to if you take it as a repair, you deduct right then on your tax returns the full $100 that you spent. This is a repair, operating expenses, I deduct it. If it's capitalized, which means it's depreciable expense, then instead of taking the $100, it's spread out over a number of years. I'm not a, obviously not, I'm an attorney, not a CPA, so I don't, you know, I don't know the ins and outs of everything, but generally that's how it works. Mm-hmm. A repair is deductible in full, you know, against your taxes, and, you know, a depreciable expense is spread out over a number of years.
Right. Okay, I don't really see any more hands raised. You guys, you can ask your question live if you would like. Just raise your hand. Someone just asked, what is DHCR's acronym? Please spell it out. So I guess they want you to...
Oh, sure. It is the Division of Housing and Community Renewal. Mm-hmm. And they're a state agency, and they're in charge of regulated apartments in New York. Not just about MCIs, but about, you know, they are in charge of all rent stabilized and regulated apartments in New York State.
Mm-hmm.
So anything to do with regulated units and other things. They do some other things, but for our purposes, they're in charge of rent regulated units.
Mm-hmm. So Michelle, we can, I guess we can close out. I think, you know,
yeah, people asked
some really good questions. And I think we are all like a little bit more clear as to what the decision means. And I think we're aware that it still can be appealed, right?
Yes.
But, you know, we have high hopes that it will get, you know, pushed through.
Right. So well, while I'm here and we have a little time, I do want to mention one other decision that our firm won in Supreme Court, also for Stuyvesant Town. This was one of the partner Tim Collins case having to do with J51. I don't know if anyone here, you know, is familiar or you live in a building with J51, but what the court basically said, Blackstone was arguing that because there had been an agreement at Stuyvesant Town that apartments would be deregulated at the end of the J51 benefits period, which was in 2020, after the passage of the HSTPA, what the court said was that, and so Blackstone was hoping to deregulate about 5,000 apartments based on a prior agreement. Our position, the tenant's position was, is that because the law changed in June of 2019, that any apartment rent stabilized as of that day remained rent stabilized, that superseded, you know, any agreement that it could be deregulated in 2020. So that's actually, that's an amazing decision. And, you know, again, we don't know whether Blackstone will appeal that, but it's a really good decision. And for any tenants who might be in buildings with a J51 that, you know, may have ended after passage of the HSTPA, this is really good for those tenants because they get to stay stabilized.
Somebody just asked, can a public housing building become a regulated development?
No, only if they're operated. They're not under the jurisdiction of DHCR as a regulated unit. I'm so sorry, my phone. So no, not unless the, they sell them somehow and make them stabilized housing, there'd have to be a new thing. But NYCHA is not subject to rent regulation. It has its own, it's under federal standards and city, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I think we can come to a closing tonight. I want to thank everybody for joining us. I want to thank Michelle for agreeing to get on this call tonight. We know it was last minute, but she came and she, you know, really gave great insight on this newly made decision. I will follow up with everybody on this call with the copy of the court decision and the schedule of capital improvements. So please be on the lookout for that. And it will also come with the copy of tonight's recorded webinar. So you can play it back and, you know, maybe share it with someone who needs to, you know, hear this information. We also want to thank our interpreter, Daniel, who's been on this call the whole time, interpreting for us. And, you know, thank you all. Have a good night. Well, before you all go, can you please answer this poll for us? And just let us know how you enjoyed tonight's webinar and let us know how, you know, it went for you all. Just take a couple seconds to answer that for me. And, you know, you guys can have a good night. Thank you, Michelle. Okay.
And Jakari, if I could just say one more thing, we will let Palante know how it's working out and how DHCR, I'm not sure how they're going to process things, but, you know, once we get more information on that, which will be vital for tenants opposing MCIs, right. We will share that when we have more information.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so thank you, everyone. Do you want to give your contact information?
Oh, sure. Should I put that in the?
You could type it in the chat.
Q&A, is that where it goes?
In the chat.
Or in the chat. Yeah, let me find it. Okay. Hold on 1 second.
If not, I could just write it for you if you want.
Yeah, I could put it in right here. Yeah.
Yeah, but thank you all for joining and I thank you all for answering the poll. We greatly appreciate it. And we will be coming out with an upcoming schedule for next month. So please be on the lookout for that because we have a lot in store for you guys.
All right, there you go. So it goes to hosts and panalists, is that?
I'll copy it and send it to everyone.
Okay, great.
Okay, so now everyone should see it.
Have a wonderful weekend, everyone.
All right, thank you, Michelle. Good night.